Do you have an encounter that you'd like to hear on this channel? If so, put all the details down in an email and send it to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. I sure hope you had a good week. We here in Southwest Ohio, we got slammed with a little bit of ice and snow, but I know a lot of other people far beyond the Ohio Valley got a lot more snow and ice, and I hope everyone came through it all okay. And even if you didn't have any snow and ice, I hope you enjoyed your pretty sun and sky. Well, tonight we have emails from two longtime Sasquatch members, and one is actually writing in because she recognized the writer and his family from another story in a video that was put out earlier in January. So, get on in there in the kitchen and plate up your snackage, top up your drink, and go get cozy. Turn on that heating blanket or stoke up the fire. We're getting ready to pull out for another journey, heading straight into Sasquatch Valley, where our only chance to catch a glimpse of one of the world's most elusive creatures is to see him before he sees us. Let's go. Hello, Nance and Sasquatch. Three different generations of my family have had encounters with Bigfoot, including myself. I've been a long-time listener, but I never thought my stories would mean anything because I've been a Pacific Northwest guy all my life, and your stories usually stick pretty close to Ohio. The first encounter happened to my dad. He was a lumberjack in Hoopa, California. He had a large dog that was never afraid of anything. He was under contract by a logging company based out of Southern Oregon to go do some work in Northern California in 1969, 2 years before I was born. He was camped on the outskirts of the town of Hoopa. His dog was with him. During the early hours of a beautiful August day, my dad's dog caught a scent of something that caused it to go running off into the forest. My dad was having his morning brew to wake himself up before a full day of work. Around 30 minutes later, he hears his dog let out the kind of yelp that you would hear a dog make after getting hit in traffic. The dog comes dragging itself into camp with a traumatized look in its eyes. Dad poured out the brew and grabs a .22 rifle that he had brought with him for protection against animals, the kind that science is aware of. A strong odor, like a mix between a dumpster and a skunk, comes drifting into camp. Now, this is the first time my dad could smell anything since the age of 14. He and two of my uncles had tangled with a family of skunks when they were boys. My dad was sprayed so bad that his nose lost the ability to smell. But he could definitely smell whatever this was, though. That is how strong it was. My dad was so shook up that he didn't leave camp that day. The sounds of something huge and pissed off was thrashing in the woods all day around his camp, all the way until early the next day. But my dad never saw the source of the smell or the noise. Unfortunately, the dog's injuries were so bad that it never made it out of California alive. Dad had to use that same rifle to send his best companion to doggy heaven. The second encounter happened to my brother, who is 6 years older than me. He and some co-workers were on a weekend hunting trip around a small northern Oregon town called Troy in 1991. They all stopped after a full summer day of hiking to rest and to catch some breath. Out of nowhere, a scream was projected at them that my brother said had to last a good full 8 minutes without the source of the scream stopping to inhale more breath. My brother and his co-workers were all big, burly, manly men who never showed fear. One of them is former military, who now works in law enforcement, and psychologically, he had years of training drummed into him, that no matter the situation, you don't break down for anything. That man found a stump to sit on and bawled like a baby when the scream finally ended. Just like my dad, they never saw anything. The third encounter was mine. I was visiting an aunt and uncle who ran a campground outside of Longview, Washington. The time was the summer, 2015. I have an issue with my throat that makes me have to clear it almost nonstop when I eat or drink something. I was out on the back deck of my family's house that overlooked the campground that they ran. I was drinking some Pepsi, and my throat was in full form. My family always had deer and elk around their campground, and my family tells me that when I clear my throat, I literally sound like a lion roaring. While I'm out on the deck, I could hear whooping sounds, but I couldn't figure out what I was hearing. Then I could hear loud thrashing sounds very close to my family's house. The sounds were so loud, I ran into the house and alerted my uncle about what I was hearing. The whole family came out on the deck and listened. My uncle is also former military, so immediately he was in full government cover-up mode, and he tried to convince me we were just hearing elk. I was positive we were not hearing elk. So my uncle went off the deck and walked around where we were hearing everything. 5 minutes later, he comes power walking out of that area with genuine fear in his eyes. My uncle is around 6'6", and when he was running around in that area, I could not hear him. He was insistent that it was an elk, but I knew what I heard was on two legs, not four. My big, manly, military uncle and I were both walking back in the house, and my uncle was so afraid, he slammed the door in my face and left me outside. Moments later, some neighbors who lived above my aunt and uncle up on a hill, they started shooting off high-powered rifles, and they were using enough ammunition to make that whole area sound like a war movie was being filmed there. I only pointed out my uncle's size because what I heard was so big and so heavy, it was crushing everything under its feet that it stepped on. But I couldn't hear anything when my uncle was moving around in that same area. Well, these are my stories, and I know that they might not be exciting enough for your channel because no one saw anything and nothing was destroyed. Signed, Brad M. Hi, Nance. This is Crystal. I've been a subscriber to your channel for a little over a year now, probably longer, actually. Nance, I finally got to sit down the other night, and to my surprise, I heard you tell an encounter that comes right out of where I live. I even know the man mentioned, Ronald Tapley, who sent it in to you. He sent in his late father's encounter. You cannot imagine the smile it put on my face just to have some sort of confirmation. I actually have had my own kind of encounters with Lord knows what over the past year or so a few times, and then once when I was real young. You see, I go with my husband to a place here in our county, McCreary County. It's called Marsh Creek. My husband's parents are buried there on their old home place site. I have a handful of stray cats that I have taken in because people set them off around here. And that is something that really bunches up the old bloomers. I can't see abandoning and starving a little animal. So I go there daily to feed them. There have been a half dozen times that everything has gotten quiet, and I heard one night something I've never heard before. It was god-awful and loud. When it quit, the coyotes started up. I only heard that one type of vocalization one time. I've never heard a vocalization like it anywhere on YouTube, and I have searched for it. After that, I put up cameras. Then I bought a night vision camcorder and a still picture taker. I've almost worn it out. I have many pictures. I believe they live here because I always sense them, and I've seen them. I heard a podcast a while back, and Robin McCrae was a guest on the show. She has a lot of experience in the Bigfoot Sasquatch world, and she talked about how she sees them around her house and interacts with them. And there have been times when she has caught them half-cloaked walking outside her home. Well, about 3 weeks ago, right before dark, I'm on my way down to the home place with my husband so I can make sure the cats get fed. We started up the old washed-out driveway to the top of the hill where the old house is, and as we turned the first curve, I looked out my side of the Jeep window and towards the old barn. I saw a long, black hair-covered arm. I lost my breath. The arm was moving in the same action it would be as if it was still attached to a power walker, but there was no body attached to it. There was just the arm. I believe we came up the hill too quick and we caught someone by surprise. I talk to them out loud all the time, and I tell them to make sure they take care of the cats because there's a few local coon hunters who like to turn their dogs loose through the property, and they just wreak havoc everywhere. They tear up the graves and things like that. If you happen to be out in the woods and you heard me talking like that, you'd think I was nuts. Absolutely banana split nuts. But I do this to show them respect. I've been told they have been there for a long, long time. I'm sending you a handful of my pictures so you can see what I'm talking about. And just as a side note, folks, I actually had to email Crystal because the email she sent, there were no photos attached. I emailed her back in January, and maybe she didn't see it, but I never did get them any other photographs. So I just wanted to let you guys know if she ever sends them, I'll be sure to put them up in a video. All right, continuing on, here's what she said. She says, Nance, you're more than welcome to put them up if you want. I know some will say there's nothing there, but some can see, and some will never be able to see. Nance, this is my encounter story. I sent it into Cam over at Dixie Cryptid about a year ago. It was on Marathon 99, and I've decided to send it to you so you can put all of this together. It's more than just a Sasquatch encounter. It's a bit of a ghostly tale included, and it's all true. Well, here goes. I hope everyone likes walking through Sasquatch Valley tonight. Just make sure you keep your eyes and ears open. They are watching. I live in McCreary County in eastern Kentucky. Growing up, we've heard all sorts of tales and things. My mother and father would tell us these stories, and when you live in Appalachia, Kentucky, these stories somehow become part of everybody's life. My mother's family had moved to Cincinnati when they were younger so my grandpa could find work. But at some point, my mother's baby sister died of crib death. In order for my grandma to come to terms with losing her baby, she had to be visited by social services. My mom had a brother that was just a year or two older than the baby, and social services took him and adopted him out. You see, crib death wasn't heard of back then. She told me that his name was Virgil, and I guess Cincinnati's social services was probably doing what they thought was the right thing. But to stop all of the heartache, Grandpa moved everybody back to Kentucky. They moved to Wilson Ridge Road in McCreary County near the Daniel Boone National Forests. Their home was the last place on the road on top of the mountain. There were other families on that road also, my father's being one of those. There were other houses too on that road, and I guess there everybody was related. Families in those mountains are rooted deep. Most always stayed there. Now keep all of this in mind, because it's relevant later on. My father began dating my mom, and my grandpa, he didn't like him very much at that time. You see, my daddy had been married before, and he was known to be a moonshining hellraiser at that time. My dad would sneak toward Mom's house, and she would sneak out after dark and meet him at the top of Grandpa's hill. There was a big mulberry tree at the top of that hill, and Mom said one night they were there kissing, and something fell out of the top of that tree, and it came down right between them and smacked Daddy upside the head. She said all he could say was, "I bet that was Lander." That was her daddy's name. Mom said all she could do was laugh. But Daddy started walking her home, and Mom said she and him could hear something in the woods. It was walking right beside them. They would stop, and it would stop. If they started, it started. Mom said this happened on many occasions. Now, this rattled a memory for my daddy, and he said when he was about 5 years old, he was walking with his brother and his mom's brother when his uncle caught a glimpse of something big and upright ahead on the road. Dad said they all yelled, "Run!" He said his feet never touched the ground all the way home. His brother grabbed his hand, and they took off. They said that once, when they were dating, they went to his aunt's house on that road. It sat right up underneath a big rock on the cliff line. Mom said there was a baby inside, crying loudly. And then something jumped off the cliff rock onto the top of the house. It shook the whole chimney, and it was thrashing all around on the roof. They thought, whatever it was going to come down that chimney. She said the women inside figured it was a panther. It had come around because it had heard the baby cry, and it was curious. But I really don't think Daddy thought the same thing at that time. Now, there are panthers here, because I've seen them. Make no bones about it. Big cats live in eastern Kentucky. My mom said that later on that night, that her and Daddy took off walking to go home. As soon as they started walking, something began paralleling them in the woods all the way home. They could hear it, like up on Grandpa's hill. Mom then told Dad to tell me about the time that Grandpa heard the ghost lady screaming near Devil's Jump. He smiled, and boy, he sure did have our attention. He said it was him and his brother and his grandpa. They went overnight fishing on the river. He said that he and his brother Jim went out to go get more refreshments to drink around midnight, and they left their grandpa there fishing. When they got back, Grandpa had moved downriver, and he was sitting on a big rock with his light. They asked him what happened, and he told them that after they left, he heard a woman screaming like she was being murdered, and the closer he would try to walk to her, the farther away she got. So that was where he decided to stop and wait, and I don't blame him. Now, here goes my face-to-face encounter. I suppose I was around 5 or 6. It was springtime, and everyone was there planting in the garden. Us kids were running all over creation, and I ran over to the wood line. I bent down to tie my shoe. I saw movement. I went a little closer, and I could see fingers attached to a hairy arm. and then there was a head. I looked directly into the eyes of this thing, but I still can't tell you what some of its features were. I stood up quickly to run, and when I looked back, it was gone. Of course, I told, but nobody believed a rowdy little kid who wouldn't stay out of the way. But Daddy did. He believed. I remember he winked at me, and he told me the safest place for me was in the front yard, and that I better get on out there. So that's my story up until what's going on today. I hope you liked this, and I hope everyone out there liked it also, because here's a secret. It's all true. Well, until next time, everyone, stay safe and God bless. Thank you, Nance, if you decide to read this. My name is Crystal, but when I was younger, my nickname was Cricket. I suppose I talked a lot. And you can say my name. I don't care. You should never be afraid of the truth. Sincerely, Crystal Douglas Trammell. Well, everyone, I have had so many different people over the years write in, and they say they hope someone hears their story from that area, or they hope someone will recognize them from the experience they're telling. But this is the first time that I have ever had someone actually really know someone who sent something in. Now, Crystal has been a member of the Sasquad for quite some time. I've seen her comments for months. I've interacted with her many times, but I had no idea where exactly she lived. I didn't even know what state. I didn't even know if she was in the United States. So when I got this email and she can identify exactly who, what, where, and the family, I'm blown away. Thank you, Crystal. And if you want to hear all about the Ronald Tapley telling his dad's short story, I'll leave a link to it in the video description below. Also, you know, Crystal said she sent those photos, and like I said, I didn't have anything attached. If she sends them in the future, I'll try to add them to another video. I also want to say thank you to Brad, who is also a very long-time and well-devoted Sasquad member. I know that sitting down to type up an email isn't the most fun thing to do on any given day, but it's helpful, and it's informative, and it is the lifeblood of this channel. So if nothing else, look around, look at Crystal, see what helped to have a little confirmation from someone else, like she said. Sometimes it really does help to get your story out there. And even if it doesn't help you so much, it just might help someone else. All right, well, listen, I've rambled on enough. I think it's time to say goodnight. And never fear, my dear Sasquad. You know we'll be getting together again in just a few days. But until then, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.